If you like this video, make sure to subscribe to our channel and hit the notification bell icon to get the latest updates.
Hi, Charan.
Hi.
My name is Venkat. I'm having 13 years of experience in IT. So currently I'm working in SAP PAAS module.
Okay. And how about the CPI? Have any idea about the CPI? Or
yeah, we just did a couple POCs, but I don't have much knowledge.
Okay. Like, you know about the sub accounts and the trial account development of SAP CPI. Parrot functions, these topics, you know, or
I not that much, okay. But I have brief idea.
Oh, okay, great. And currently, you are working for which technology?
Yes, PIPO.
Oh, PIPO, great. 13 years of experience on PIPO or above?
Almost 11 to 12.
Oh, great. Okay. Yeah, okay. My name is Sharan, and you know, I have more than 10 plus years of experience on SAP CPI, and I am a corporate trainer where I provide the trainings for the freshers where from my company, and also I am SAP CPI and PIPO certified, and also I am, you know, I work for both PIPO and CPI simultaneously.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, let me start from slide. Okay. Okay. Basically, first of all, you have to understand cloud and on-premise. Okay. We have two words. One is cloud and one is on-prem architecture. Okay. Now, first of all, most of them already we work for on-prem, right? Because the PIPO is an on-prem architecture where you have to install the software and you have to do the maintenance and everything. But the cloud is completely different. Nowadays, you can see most of the application, they are planning to move for the cloud because it's a high scalable and highly available, right? Now, whenever you want to use any application, suppose if you want to utilize any SSL application, now what you have to do, you just go to your Google account, then you can, from there, you can just access the Excel sheet and you just upload it, or if you want to update any information, you just do there, right? But if you go for an on-prem, what you have to do, you have to install the Microsoft Excel, then you have to do the any modifications. If you do the modifications, then again, what you have to do, again, from the tomorrow, if you want to do that, again, you have to go to your system and again, you have to do the, all the process, right? But if you have your cloud application, which is Excel, then you can access from your mobile also. You just log into the your Google account and where you can access from internet. But the main important from between the cloud and on-premise is the cloud more 99.99% runs on the internet only. Everything will be stored and everything will be on the internet. Okay, now if I take the on-prem architecture, let's assume you have your company, okay, and the enterprise has the so many services. Okay, let's assume the company has managed their own servers, okay, and the own resources, okay, the deployment they have to do and everything done by their own. Okay, they're not depends on someone. They have to install and they have to buy and they have to manage and they have to deploy everything, right? Now that is coming under on-prem architecture. Within the company level, they have to do the all the operations. But if you go for an on-prem architecture, cloud architecture, now let's assume it's a cloud architecture, okay? So you can make it as a cloud architecture. Now, if I give you a simple example that you can easily understand what is a cloud and basically what mainly it consists. Suppose if you are utilizing an electricity, okay? Now you are sitting in your home and you utilize the electricity, but you never think about how the electricity is generating and the how they are storing the electricity and the how the electricity reached to your location, right? You never think about that. And only what you will do, you just use that power consumption, you consume the electricity and on monthly basis, you will pay the bill, correct? Now, same is like in cloud also. They'll store the data. Suppose if you do any operation, if you update any database, then the data will be added and updated in the backend on clouds. But you will never see the how the data is storing and how they're do the modifications and everything. Because only you think about how the utilization, how you are accessing the any front-end application. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You clear with the both difference, right? Yeah. On-premise and cloud. Okay. Now, let's give you a definition of cloud computing. Okay. Now, the word is a cloud in the sense everything is working on the internet. Now, the computing in the sense, suppose if you do any operation, okay, suppose if you want to do the, it's a very flexible. Now, if you want to do any simple operation, like if you want to delete some data, then what you have to do, if it is the on-prem, you have to log into your system and you have to switch on your system and you have to do the, all the operations. But if it is the cloud in the sense that everything you can do from your mobile, laptop, tab, or anywhere, it's not for the particular. It will be from anywhere you can do any operation or anything. The computing in the sense, you do the operations or anything from the internet only. There is a no word of going for an on-premise or installations or something. Everything is installed by some third-party vendors and they provide to you. You just utilize the services. That's it. You will never think about the how the installation is happening and how they do the maintenance and everything. It's a 24/7. You can utilize that and highly available. That is the reason we are mostly are going for an clouds. Now, if I say the complete concept which is running on the cloud, that we called as cloud computing. Now mainly you have to think about three services. Okay, now mainly whenever, suppose if I give you some data, what you have to think, first of all you have to think about the how much data it is, like it's a 1 KB or 2 KB or 100 KB, right? That is coming under storage. Now second one is an service, like the suppose which software you are utilizing. Suppose if you are using some front-end application, like suppose you know the success factor, right? The success factor and Ariba. These are called as some softwares, which is already developed by some third-party vendors. Now you're just utilizing, okay? When I say the software within the cloud that is already installed or already updated or already deployed by some third-party vendors, you are just utilizing the services without doing any installation or anything. You just open some URL, then you can access the data and you can update the data. You can do anything. Okay, that is a software. Now, mainly this cloud computing is divided into three parts. Okay, the main is software as a service and the platform as a service and infrastructure as a service. Okay, let me go for that and I'll come back and you will clearly understand the benefits of this. Now, the cloud computing is basically divided into three. One is infrastructure as a service, then platform as a service, and software as a service. When I say infrastructure as a service, it's all about the storage on the cloud. Okay, whatever the application you are utilizing or whatever the thing you do, everything should be stored somewhere, right? There should be a database which is sitting on the internet, like clouds. That is called an infrastructure as a service. I'll give you a brief about this, but first of all, I'll give you the definition. Then we have platform as a service. When I say platform as a service, you have to do everything from the scratch. Like you have to do your own design and you have to do the testing. And finally, you have to do the deployment. Then that will coming under platform as a service. Okay, there will be some platform. Now you have to create some services and you have to do the testing and you have to do the deployment. Then that will be coming under platform as a service. Now, as I told you, software as a service is some third-party vendors, they'll provide the software. Just you have no need to do any installation. You just utilize service by using some URLs. Suppose if you want to log into the Ariba, then you just open the URL. That's it, right? You no need to install any software or anything. Okay, now if I give you the brief examples, how software as a service and platform as a service, as I told you, software as a service is some third-party vendors, they provide the software. You have to utilize the software. Now, we know the most of the examples are SuccessFactors and Ariba and Concur. These are the softwares which are already provided by the third-party vendors. You're just utilizing those softwares, okay, without any installation. Now, platform as a service, this is the CPI is the best example for the platform as a service because you have to do your own design and you have to do your own testing and deployment. Whenever if there is a design, development, and testing, then we can say platform as a service. Now, infrastructure as a service. it's all about the storage. Okay, the storage, something is happening on the internet that we called as infrastructure as a service. But when I say it's an on-prem, then the infrastructure as a service will be not there. It's kind of, you can say, database or something. But if it is the cloud, then we can say infrastructure as a service, in the sense the data which is storing on the internet. Now the SAP CPI applications and everything, they store the data in the SAP converged cloud. And we also know the Google Drive, right, which stores the data and you can access anytime, anywhere. Okay, because that is under the infrastructure as a service. Any doubts here?
No, good, sir.
Okay. And this mainly, as I already explained, we have the software as a service, platform as a service, and infrastructure as a service. Now, when I say who use it, is in the sense, suppose if you are a business user, okay, now you are working for any success factor system. Okay, now what you have to do, you will not create any software, right? You just utilize the software which is already created by some third party vendors. That is the reason business users, they can use this Ariba or SuccessFactor or anything. Now the platform as a service, the word, it is a platform as a service in the sense, suppose if you consider a CPI as an example, who can access the CPI? The developers can access the CPI, right? Suppose if you do the design and testing, then deployment, then the developer can have the all the access to all these things. That is the reason platform as a service, who can use it is developers. Now we have the infrastructure as a service. Now, if you know about SAP PIPO, we have the basis team, which they maintain the all the data credentials and everything, right? Now the system admins, they can access, they can store the data in their own database servers within the company level. Okay, now the system admins can use the infrastructure as a service. Now, what you will get it when you subscribe for any software as a service or platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, you will get an software application which is running on the internet. It's not an installation. It's just an software service which is available on the internet. Then in the platform as a service, you will get a platform, development platform, where you can do your own design and testing on everything. Now here is the computing resource where you can do the all the database management, or you can do many things like analysis, everything. That is the reason computing resource will be coming under infrastructure as a service. Okay, this already I explained you, but this is a brief idea you have to understand. What is the software as a service, and what is the platform as a service, and what is the infrastructure as a service? Because whenever you go for interview, if they ask what are the services we have, then the CPI consisting of all this, because the CPI will be running on storing the data somewhere, that then it will coming under infrastructure as a service. Then the CPI will connect with the third party applications like Ariba, SuccessFactor and Concur. Then the software as a service also come to the picture. Whenever, when I say CPI, then it combination of all the software as a service, platform as a service and infrastructure as a service. Okay. Now here is the important word that you have to remember, because whenever you start with your CPI, then every time you can see the business technology platform, which is called SAP BTP. This we called, also called as cockpit. Okay, I'll show you cockpit. Now, when I say BTP, it's a like a root. Okay, under this business technology platform, you have multiple services. Okay, now I will explain you this example, then you will get a better understanding. Now, suppose you have Make My Trip like a BTP. Now, Make My Trip is a BTP. And in the Make My Trip application, you have multiple services. You have flight services, hotel services, holidays, trains, and so many. Now you can utilize any services based on your requirement. Suppose if you are going for some other location to the flight, then you can go for the flight service and you can utilize that. Then you can, if you want to go by train, then you can utilize that. Okay. There are so many services, but you can utilize which service you want. Now BTP also say it has all the services. You can see this is the BTP, this complete screen is the BTP, and under the BTP we have multiple services, ABAP environment, audit log, these all are the services. Now under this we have to think about the integration suite, because the CPI will be coming under integration suite. Now we no need to think about all this part, like no need to concentrate more about all these services, because our concentration, as we are an SAP CPI developers, we have to think about this integration suite. whenever you subscribe for the integration suite, under integration suite, you will get an 4 services. Okay. One is SAP CPI, and one is API management, and one is open connectors, and one is integration advisors. Now, as you know, SAP CPI is an cloud platform integration, which is using to integrate multiple systems. Okay. I'll give you the brief about what is an integration. I think you are from SAP PI background, then you will understand what is an integration. Now you want to integrate multiple systems in the internet, then you just use an SAP CPI as a middleware. Okay, then we have an SAP API management. Suppose you have your on-premise data like SAP ECC, or you have your CRM application or something. Now you want to expose your on-premise data to the any third-party application which is running on the internet. Then what you have to do is you have to expose the data to the internet from the API management, because API management will give you the one layer of security whenever if the customer or anyone want to access the data of your on-premise system. First, you have to connect to the API management. Then the API management will check is the user is a valid user or not. If the user is valid user, then API management will allow you to access the data. Otherwise, it will not allow you to access the data. And in the API management, we have many kinds of authentication. Like we have an basic authentication, and we have an OAuth authentication, and we have an API keys, and so many. You can use anything based on your requirement. Now we have open connectors. Now suppose whenever if your CPI system want to connect with any third-party applications, like we have a standard connectors. Okay, suppose if I give you an example, we have an OneDrive, okay, and we have the Google Drive, and we have Salesforce, like this kind of application, we don't find any adapters. If I say adapter, we know in the PIP, right? Suppose if it is the database, then you just use the JDBC. Likewise, suppose if you want to connect with the Google application, then there will be no standard adapter. Suppose if you want to connect with an OneDrive, there will be no standard adapter. In that case, what you have to do is, all these services, all the third-party applications which are available on the on-premise, under on-prem open connectors, then you have to create simple instance in the open connectors. Then you are connecting with your own open connector application with an CPI. Then you can access the data. Instead of creating the individual adapter for the each and every application, we have an open connectors. It contains the most of the applications. Then from the application, you can connect with an SAP CPI. Now we have integration advisor, where suppose you know the concept of EDI, right? And yeah, whenever you want to do the EDI process, we have an BTP, B2B IC in the SAP PIPO. But in the CPI, we have an integration advisor, which will handle all kind of data. Like if you are sending the ANSI X12 or ED fact or anything, it can handle all the data. You just create simple template from here in under integration advisor. Then you just utilize the same template in your CPI. Okay. Now all these services are related to the SAP CPI, because whenever you connect with an any on-premise system to the any cloud application, then you just go for an API management. First, your SAP CPI will connect with an API management, then API management to your on-premise system. Now the same in the open connectors also. You have to connect your any third-party application to the CPI, then you just use an open connector concept, like same for integration advisor also, because these four are very important, and these four services will be coming under integration suite. Whenever if you buy the integration suite, then it will be a combination of all the four services. Now this all are coming under BTP, like cockpit. Under the integration suite, we have these four services.
Okay. One question, Charan.
Yeah.
So here in CPA is comes with standard adapters, right?
Yeah, correct.
So what is the difference between open and CPA? Of course, open connectors has many.
Yeah.
But standard open, adapters.
Yes, correct. That's a good question. Now let's assume you want to access any application. Okay. Suppose if you want to access the Salesforce application. Now, whenever you want to access any third-party application, there should be a lot of authentication. You have to get the token, and again, you have to send the token to the third party to check the this token is valid or not. Okay. And again, you have to store the token. Okay. All this steps will be coming under whenever if you are not go for an open connectors. But when you go for open connectors, you just create one instance in an open connector. Then you just use simple URL in the SAP CPI. Then you can directly access the data from any third-party application to your CPI. But whenever without the open connectors, if you want to access the most of the application, they have their kind of authentication like OAuth authentication. They'll send the request, then they'll get the access token. All this stuff, we have to do the more steps. We have to do the storage by using the Ruby step, all this coming under picture.
No, for Salesforce and those things are okay. But for example, let's say we have only one web service, JSON-based web service with basic authentication.
Yeah, then you just upload the WSDL in SAP CPI. This is not mandatory. Every time you have to go for an open connector. If there are a specific reason that you have a specific requirement, suppose if you want to connect with an OneDrive, okay? If the requirement is OneDrive, then what you have to do, you use the open connector. And if you go to open connectors, if you search for the OneDrive, then you will find the OneDrive. You just create an instance, then you can use it. It's not mandatory that you have to go every time to the open connectors.
So what happens if we have both standard adapter is available and open connector is available? Which one we go on?
Based on your flexibility. Based on your flexibility. Suppose if I want to store the tokens and everything in the CPI, then I can just go for an SAP CPI. That's not everything. But the final agenda is you have to connect with your CPI with any third-party application. It's not mandatory that you can go for this or go for that.
Now, if both are available, which one is the preferred one?
CPI is the preferred one.
Okay, standard adapters.
Yeah, because the standard adapters we have, and we have more flexibility.
Okay.
When we go for SAP CPI. And many steps will be decreased when you skip the open connectors. But if it is the systems are not available and adapters are not available in the SAP CPI, then what you have to do, instead of creating the own custom adapter, you just use an open connector concept.
Okay. And integration advisor is only for EDI?
Yes, it's a integration advisor. Basically, it's a EDI. Okay. Now, suppose if you have one EDI system, want to send the data to the ECC, then there should be a standard structure, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because EDI will not understand all kind of languages. It's understand only few. Then you have to, it's a mandatory go for an integration advisor. Suppose if you have the custom structure, they're not sending in the EDI format, then you directly use a direct SAP CPI without using the integration advisor. Mm-hmm. But if the concept of EDI, then you just go for an integration advisor. Okay, any question?
No, thank you, sir.
Okay, now these are the six important concepts that you have to understand in an SAP CPI. Okay, now first one is out-of-box integration. Now, what is an out-of-box integration? Suppose if you want to use any web application, let's assume, I'll give you a simple example. Suppose if you want to use a calculator example, okay? Now, what you have to do, instead of creating the WSDL from the scratch, you just go to the internet and you just search for calculator WSDL, correct? Now, what you do, you just download that and you can utilize that in your scenarios, correct? Now, the out-of-box integration also same. The CPI packages all are available in the Discover page where you can utilize 825 prepackaged integration to your integration scenarios. Okay, it's kind of dictionary where it contains all the prepackaged contents. Now, instead of creating iFlow from the scratch, what you can do is you just copy the integration which is available and which is related to your requirement. You just copy the integration flow to your tenant and you can access that. Okay, that is about out-of-box integration. Clear?
Yeah.
Then we have simple semantic APIs. Now, SAP provided 725 plus APIs. Okay, suppose if you want to connect with any system, C4C, let's assume you want to connect with a C4C application. Now C4C application want to interact with an SAP CPI. The SAP already provided 425 plus pre-built, already created APIs. Now what you what you have to do is you just use the same APIs to your SAP CPI. Suppose in the out of 725, there will be one C4C. Now, instead of directly connecting with the C4C, here already configurations and everything, they're published in the format of APIs. Now, whenever you want to access any C4C data, then what you do is you directly utilize the C4C API, then you just utilize the same in the SAP CPI. I'll show you how to use this, but if the already created APIs are available, then you just utilize that.
Okay.
Then we have an open connector concept. As I told you, we have 150 plus connectors, means there are 150 applications, 150 plus applications that you can use that, okay, anywhere in your SAP CPI, whenever we connect with any application. And we have integration advisor, where now, as I told you, it's all about the EDI. Now we have the cloud deployment and pay as you go. Now let's assume you subscribe for any service. Okay, now let's assume you are subscribed for integration suite. Now integration suite has four services. Okay, one is CPI and integration advisor, API management, and open connectors. Now you are not utilizing the open connectors and you are not utilizing the API management. Then you have to pay only for the CPI. Okay, that is the reason, pay as you go. How much you use, that much you have to pay. And whenever you pay, you just start to use the services. Now, multi-cloud deployment offering. Now, as I told you, if the multi-cloud in the sense, it has a combination of both on-premise and cloud. Suppose if your SuccessFactor want to integrate with the on-premise application. Now, the SuccessFactor will send the data to the SAP CPI. Then CPI will be send the data to the ECC system. Now, the CPI will be useful for multi-cloud in the sense both on-premise system, it can send the data, and also it can send the data to the SuccessFactor. It's a cloud application. That is the reason it's a multi-cloud deployment of features.
A multi-cloud, it's not different clouds? Because it says multi-cloud.
No, multi-clouds in the sense, it's a, if you can see, deployment offering choice. Like it will allow you to deploy anywhere. Like you can deploy your software in the, when you connect with an on-prem, also whenever you want to connect with the cloud application, it will allow you to add any data. That is the multi-cloud deployment offering.
Okay.
Okay. And also here you can see hyperscale, right? What is the basic of hyperscale? It can be a both public cloud as well as a private cloud. Public cloud in the sense anyone can access.
Yeah,
anyone can access.
Different clouds, right? So we can deploy in any cloud.
Yes, correct. It's a both publicly and private available, anything. Okay.
Yeah.
And I think you know about these things.
Yeah.
Let me skip this, because all this integration part, you know. Okay. And one more thing here, you have to think. Okay. Suppose if you have a simple requirement, you have your XML data, okay? The source sending the XML data. So the target is expecting the JSON format. In CPI, what you will do, suppose if the this is the requirement, then you have to use an REST adapter, then you have to convert that into JSON format or something like. But if it is in the SAP CPI, we have a simple function called as convert XML to JSON. Okay, you just do the simple connection, then that's it. There no need to do any channel configurations or anything. It's a simple, when we compare with an PIPO, the CPI. Okay. And this is the big architecture. We have all these things. Okay, before I jump into this big architecture, first I'll show you how the SAP CPI system look like. Then if I give you an example, the sender is sending the data, then all this stuff, then you will get a clear picture. Instead of if I explain you this, I will give you the how to create the CPI access and everything. I'll show you how.
So currently I don't have access.
Yeah, you don't have access, right? Do you have an access for this SAP CPI?
No, through our company, I use it to have access, but I did not check from last couple of months.
Okay, okay. No issues. I'll show you how to create your own trial account and how to utilize it. You know the like the process how to create the trial account and how to utilize?
No.
Okay, no problem. I'll show you. Okay. Let me. Okay. I'll explain all these options, but before that, you have to understand this architecture. Okay, that is the reason I am starting with the simple. Okay, now you know the sender systems and the receiver system. Now the sender system want to connect with an SAP CPI system. Okay, this part you can say SAP CPI, and this is the sender system and this is the receiver system. Now your sender system want to connect with an SAP CPI. Then what you have to do is you just give a simple connection, and these are the adapters. You know in the PIP, right? Likewise, we have the so many adapters. Based on our requirement, you have to utilize that. Okay, let me first go for an postman. I'll use the HTTP. Then suppose I want to send to my mail. Okay, I want to send some data to the mail. Okay, I'll use the mail adapter. Now, let me use. I'll explain you all this, but we just. Now you can see the sender system connected with the SAP CPI, and CPI is sending some data to the receiver system. The configuration part, you just forgot about that. Okay, now the sender system connected with CPI connected with the receiver system. Now, here is the important thing that you have to remember. Here are the four options, right? One is discover, and one is design, and one is monitoring. Now let me duplicate this. Okay, now this is where actual design you have to do. Okay, suppose if you do some design, everything you have to do in between start message and end message. Okay, I'll explain you clearly, but where you have to do the all the steps. Now this is what the architecture explained you. If I go to this architecture, now here you can see this is the sender system. Okay, now the sender system is connected with an SAP CPI, and CPI is sending some data to the receiver system. Okay, now in between you can see two nodes. One is tenant management node and one is runtime node. Okay, now you have to remember two words. One is TMN, tenant management node, and second one is runtime node. Now whenever you send the data, first it will hit a tenant management node. Now what is the tenant management node? The front end screen, you can see this is the tenant management node. Okay. Now, whatever the monitoring screen, you can see that is the worker node or runtime node. Okay. Here you can see tenant management node and runtime node. Whenever you can do any design, that will coming under tenant management node. Whenever if it is in the monitoring, then it called as runtime node. Now what happening, first you are triggering some message. Now it first hit the tenant management node, actual flow. Now this tenant management can access by the developer. Okay, correct, right? Because this developer can have an access of change the iFlow or design the iFlow, or anything can be done from the developer. That is the reason tenant management node will be connected with an developer. Now, whenever to start the runtime node, okay, this tenant management will start the runtime node. Okay, whenever suppose if you want to start any process, always tenant management node and runtime node always should be in the sync. Okay, the runtime node will be start the tenant management node, either the data is stop or process or anything. This is like an kind of key where it can do all the operations, like it can start the iFlow or it can stop the iFlow. Anything can be done from runtime. Now, if you can say how it will work, okay, let me show you how it will work. If I go to the monitoring, now you can see the flow is demo 01, correct? 11. Now I can go here. Demo 11, it's not here, correct? Now I'll just save this and I just click on deploy. Okay. Whenever I click on deploy, in the sense, it will act as an key, right? Because if you see now, you can see demo 11 is here. Okay. Before demo 11 is not there. Now you can see demo 11 is there. Now this will be act as an key where it start the iFlow and stop the iFlow or everything can be done from here. Okay. Now it's getting starting. If you see, it's started. Now these two are in the sync. Now, whatever the operation you do, it always related to this monitoring screen. Okay. This is called as worker node and this is called as tenant management. Okay. Now, suppose you want to send some data from the sender system, then you send the data to the tenant management node. Now, whenever you send the data to the tenant management node, the backend, this runtime node will be execute all the processes. It stores the data, it accesses the data and it do all the operations. And finally, it sent to the receiver system. This is from the sender. It sent the data. Then finally, the receiver system will receive the data. Now here you can see load balancer. Now why we need to use the load balancer? Load balancer is kind of, it will manage the data flow. Suppose if you are sending the 10 GB data, now the CPI will not able to handle the data. Then the load balancer will split the data and it transfer the data and it send the data. Okay, load balancer is kind of managing the data, everything. And also load balancer will be access and security where it will check the either the user is exist or not, or this is the particular user has an access or not. Everything will be handled by the load balancer. That is the reason administrator can connect with the load balancer. Also administrator can connect with then tenant management because he can give the access of edit access or write access or only view access. Anything can be done by administrator and he can manage all the credential part. That is the reason the load balancer will be managed by the administrator and also the tenant management he can able to access, but the this tenant management node will be accessed by a developer also. Okay. Clear or any doubt here?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Yeah, now I have some data here. Now let me it will generate one URL. I'll explain you this also, but for now I'll just send some data from the sender system, then it hits the CPI and it's sent to the target system. Okay, now you can see this is the test is successfully sending from the sender system 200. Okay, now the same data will be received to the SAP CPI. Okay, all these steps I'll explain you clearly, but
no,
just a over
brief idea.
Yeah, now you can see the message is completed, in the sense the CPI successfully sent the data to the receiver system. Now let me open my mail where I use the receiver system as my mail. Okay, now you can see this is the test which I sent from the sender system. Now this is how the SAP CPI work. First we are sending some data from the sender system, then here we use an adapters to connect with the systems, then here actual SAP CPI modifications and everything will be done here, then the finally we are sending the data to the target system. Okay, the same thing is, if you suppose, let's assume here is authentication. Instead of this, I'll use something else. Okay. Instead of @gmail, I'll send something. Now you can see 401 unauthorized. Now this load balancer will come to picture and it make it as unauthorized, because whenever you send the request, this load balancer has the authentication and all the information. It will check, okay, this user is exist. Then it will allow you to run the iFlow. Then at the same time, it send the transfer the data to the runtime node, because you want to view either the message is completed or failed or everything. Everything will be stored here in the format of encrypting. Okay, encrypted format, the data will be stored in the monitoring. Okay, no one can able to access, only the edit person or admin or who has the access provided by the admin, they can only access or view the data. But if it is the production, we are not able to see any data. They can, we have only view access. Okay, then the system receiver from the runtime node, it successfully sent to the receiver system. Okay.
Yeah.
Any doubt here?
No.
Okay. Now this is the same thing. Okay. This tenant management node and description, they can share this one. Okay. Now this is a simple example. You have to think when you start SAP CPI. Okay. Now let's assume this is your SAP CPI. Okay. Now you want to access or you want to get any information or you want to hit any URL, then first we have an multiple options where the data will be storing, okay, all the credentials and everything. Now suppose you hit some URL, it will go to the identity providers where the user, if you can see here some username, right, it will check the user is exist or not. If the user is exist, then it will allow you to access for the particular user. Okay. Here is, we have multiple, like here we have Facebook, Microsoft, like that, right? And in the CPI, we have two. One is security key, like it has the both client ID and client secret. Then we have username and password. Instead of Facebook, Microsoft, Google, we have two options. One is username and password, and one is service key. It has both client ID and client secret. Whenever you hit the username, first it will check the identity provider, like the database. I'll show you where the identity providers and everything look like and where we can store the username and password. But whenever you try to hit, it will first check the user is exist or not. If the user is exist, then this SAP cockpit will allow you to access for the particular CPI flow. Okay. This is how it will work. Suppose you can think in a broad picture where you are sending some data. Okay. Then it hits the, instead of API management, you just think about SAP CPI. Okay. And here is the identity provider where first it will, instead of giving the access to the SAP CPI flow, it directly redirects to the identity provider. And identity provider will check the user is existing or not. If the user is exist, then it will allow you to access the CPI flow. If it is not, then it will cancel the user can not able to access any CPI flow. Okay, it's kind of cycle where it checks the credentials and everything. I'll show you how this big picture will look in SAP CPI, all this stuff. Okay, now you just note this URL. https://, let me put this on the chart.
I have this PPT.
Okay, you have this PPT. You just open this URL. And once you open this URL, you just go to here and go to Asia Pacific, then you just click on India. Okay, then you will be redirected to here. Now you just go to here, log on option. Then here it will ask you for the business email address. Sorry, I just already logged in. That is the reason it automatically redirect, because it's using SAML assertion. I'm just go to here. You just click on this option. And here you just use an business email address, okay? Either your daily use Gmail or anything. Then the first name, then the last name, the company. And here you just give your mobile number, then department and relationship with SAP. You just give the consultant or customer or anything. Okay, then just click on submit. Once you click on submit, you will get an one URL to your mail. Whatever the mail you mentioned, right? The same you will get. And you just confirm that.
Activate that one.
Yeah, you activate it.
So we can use US number also, right? Here.
Yeah, yeah, you can use. But you have to change this phone to press one. Okay. Did you approve that?
No.
Yeah. Happy. Okay. Okay. Then you just use this second URL.
But I thought you are giving me the access, not from this SAP.
Which one?
That for the system, you are giving the access
from the system,
not from PSAP. Yeah,
I'm not getting you. Like, you are not able to log into this. This one,
no, this is a standard SAP trial account, right?
Yeah, you have this account,
no, but I think this is valid for a month.
No, this will be coming 1 year.
Okay.
Yeah. You just enter the details and finally you will get an mail and you just approve that. That's it. Because any user, they want to access any SAP application, first they have to register here on SAP.
No, they said they'll give me the access, not from this free trial.
Okay. Otherwise, just share your screen. I'll write you.
Yeah, I love this.
Yeah, okay. Then you just use this second URL. This is the cockpit URL.
This is also there in the presentation?
No, it's not there in the presentation. I just put on chat. You can copy that.
I don't see any message in the chat. Sorry.
No message. Okay.
I think it's only going to the host.
Okay. Okay, then you just search with this BTP trial logon. You can see in my screen, right? cockpit.hana-trial-on-demand.com.
BTP trial login?
Yeah. You just search for that BTP trial logon.
Here also we have to register.
Yeah, it will automatically capture your mobile number, right? It will show you the will get the OTP.
Yeah, it automatically logged in.
Yeah.
Are waiting for anything, sir?
No. Now, are you able to create the account or you enter the OTP?
Did not ask anything. It's automatically logged in.
Okay. Now you are able to see which screen?
Get started for free SAP business technology platform.
Okay. You just share your screen. I think again the host.
Yeah, I'm not able to. Is Sam is there? Or?
Oh, sorry.
Is Sam is there? Because it's not allowing the host disable.
Okay. I can there. What is his name?
Sam.
Let me try to. Hey, hi, Sam, are you there?
Can you log in here and see which screen will come?
No, if I log in, I directly redirect to my cockpit. I'll show you it. Because if you do from the first time, then the screen will be different. It will create all the sub accounts and everything. Let me.
No. I already have an account because I just entered my credentials.
Okay. Okay, give me a second. He's calling. Okay, you can see the screen or?
No, not
this one. Okay, it should be this one. Okay, now you just search for cockpit. HANA trial, even you don't have access for chart types, right? You just type with this cockpit.hanatrial.ondemand.com/trial.
Yeah, that's the phone number.
Yeah, now we just enter the form and we'll get the OTP.
Upgrade. No, I was under the impression that they will give me the account, but it's not like I'm creating my own test trial account.
Yeah, this is a trial account. Like you can create n number of trial accounts for your testing purpose. It's not like someone.
No. They said they are going to give me.
Okay, who?
Actual account. Sam,
like whom? From this consultancy or from the training?
Yeah, from the training.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they additionally charge for this also.
Oh, it's a free trial. Yeah.
Are you able to?
Yes. You just use an US. Yeah, create account. Yeah, let's wait for 2 minutes, then your account will be created. Okay, this is how the BTP look like. Okay, you can see the welcome to SAP BTP trial, right? That is business technology platform, and it has all these sub accounts and global account. Okay, main is a global account. Under the global account, you can create multiple sub accounts. Okay, I'll explain you this, no worry, but you just copy this URL somewhere. Also, you can just bookmark this for the future purpose. Whenever you want to log into the trial account, you just click on that URL. Then you just automatically redirect here.
Hello, Sam.
Yeah. So just bookmark, right?
Okay. Yeah. You just go to trial account. Yeah, just close this. Yeah, from here you can have to create an all. You just click on this trial. No, here you can see the provider, right? Downside provider region environment.
Yeah.
Box. Yeah, you just click on this. Okay, under this you have to subscribe the services and everything. Okay, now this is the global account. Under the global account, you have multiple sub accounts. Now you have this sub account, right? Try. Likewise, you can create n number of sub accounts based on your requirements for the development system one, production system one, quality one, differently. Okay. Okay. You just keep till here. Okay. And tomorrow I'll show you what are the services you have to subscribe and what are the roles you have to add. All this stuff I'll explain.
Okay.
Yeah. You got it right. Brief idea how. Okay. Any questions?
No. Not as of now.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. We'll connect tomorrow.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you for attending the session. I hope you all enjoyed it. Don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel. Also, feel free to ask your questions in the comment section below, and we will reply to them at the earliest.